Okay, good morning everyone. Good afternoon, wherever you are. Welcome to Mask Ultrasound Zoom meeting. And we're so privileged to have a very distinguished speaker today. Her name is Dr. Linh Vuong from Harbor, UCLA. And he's a family medicine physician and a sports medicine physician. And she has been active in teaching prolotherapy in the United States and internationally, and also with cooperation with Hackett Hemwell Patterson Foundation since 2009. So we are so privileged that he would be talking to today an effective evidence-based non-surgical approach to treat MSK injuries, which is focused actually on prolotherapy literature review. So today, before we begin, let us just pause for a moment for a short prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you that you've given us this privilege of learning new things from Dr. Linh Vuong. I know she has prepared very well, and we are here to learn from her. Thank you for giving her wisdom and understanding from above. Kindly be with us, Lord, and kindly teach us to trust in you always, wherever we go. Kindly send your holy angels to keep watch over us, that we may be safe in all, everything that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So Dr. Linh Vuong, welcome to Mask Ultrasound Zoom meeting. Go ahead.
I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to share with you a topic I'm very, very passionate about. And I'd like to thank Dr. David Robago and all my colleagues and mentors in the HHP Foundation and around the world. A special thanks to my husband, Fu, and my sister, Tin, for their support with everything that I do. I have no pharmaceutical affiliations. My sister and I have an integrative MSK practice called AcuProlo Institute in Los Angeles, California, that offers prolotherapy, PRP, perineural injection therapy, acupuncture, and osteopathy. So the objectives for this 1.5 hour talk is that I'll start off with an overview of pain with the classifications of pain and therapies for pain, the big picture in regenerative therapy, treating the body as a whole, reviewing osteopathic principles and biotin integrity model. This is very key when you're treating pain, and especially regenerative therapy. Then we go straight into prolotherapy, history, indications, contraindications, and complications. And the bulk of the lecture will be on prolotherapy research. I will review basic science, clinical research, and interesting case reports. And lastly, we will review how Prolo can complement your practice. So before we start, I'd like to share with you a story. Last year, my husband and I took our kids to the Philippines for a friend's wedding. And we were so impressed by the beauty of the country and the friendliness of the people. While we visited a refugee camp where my husband stayed before coming to America. And we met up with his childhood friend who still lived there 34 years later with her kids in this makeshift shelter. It reminded me of my own family struggles as Vietnamese refugees and how not everyone can afford to live in a castle. So putting things into perspective, it's imperative to find cost-effective ways to help relieve pain and suffering in the world, because the chronic pain burden is huge, with an increased prevalence and severity of MSK pain worldwide. 80% of adults get low back pain at some point in their lifetime. The CDC estimates that 90% of the US $3.5 trillion in annual healthcare expenditures are for people with chronic pain and mental health conditions. That's more than the yearly cost for cancer and heart disease and diabetes. And unfortunately, there's a lack of effective conventional therapy. So people are using opioids, and there's a healthcare crisis, and patients are paying out of pocket for alternative therapies to treat pain. So let's briefly review the different types of pain. The International Association for the Study of Pain, IASP, defines pain as an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage. Now, you're all familiar with nociceptive pain. So that's the stimulation of a nociceptive nerve ending in response to injury or stimuli. And the duration is usually acute, but it can progress to become chronic. That's the mechanical low back pain, post-op pain, sports injuries, arthritis, and sickle cell. Then there's the neuropathic pain, and that's injury to the nervous system, and it's usually chronic. That's the post-herpetic neuralgia, trigeminal neuralgia, CRPS, peripheral neuropathy, neuropathic low back pain. Now, in 2017, the International Classification of Diseases formed a new classification system for pain. That's nociplastic pain. That's altered nociceptive function without a structural defect. And these things are usually chronic. That's the fibromyalgia, the IBS, and nonspecific low back pain. Now, pain is very complicated. There's also, you can have a mixture of any one of those combinations. So in treating pain though, we have to look at it as a multimodality approach. The more tools you have in your toolbox, the better you can help patients. So treatment should always be patient-centered and include addressing cognitive behavioral aspects. You start off with the least invasive treatment, then you add on things plus or minus interventional therapies. The patient's condition is constantly changing during therapy, so it's going to require that you have continuous reevaluation and different combinations of therapies at different times during the healing process. So now there's a huge move towards non-surgical reconstructive therapy as a treatment for pain. So let's look at the big picture of regenerative therapy. Prolotherapy was the first type of regenerative therapy. It was also known as proliferative therapy, regenerative therapy, non-surgical reconstructive, and it was the only regenerative injection therapy then. Then in the last decade, it was a race to find ways to stimulate regrowth more so. And we came up with platelet-rich plasma. We then came up with ozone, they call it prolozone, or stem cells and bone marrow concentrate. As you can see, these other types of regenerative therapies are more costly than prolotherapy. So why should we consider prolo? Prolo is the oldest and most cost-effective regenerative therapy. It's evidence-based, promoting healing, decreased pain, improved function. It treats a variety of MSK conditions. It's non-surgical, can be done safely by trained professionals using palpation-guided standardized protocols. It does not require fancy equipment or imaging, and it can be done in children and adults. It can be done in third world countries. Prolo has the potential to make a huge global impact. So what's in the Prolo solution that's responsible for all the healing? There's many different concoctions over the years. One can argue that any agent that causes tissue proliferation is considered as prolotherapy. However, in the rapidly changing field of orthobiologics, when one talks about prolotherapy, it is commonly assumed to be hypertonic dextrose. We will see later that the mechanism for dextrose is multifactorial. Usually we use 10 to 20% dextrose to inject extra-articular structures and 25% for intra-articular. The greatest thing about dextrose is that it's cheap, it's abundantly available, so you can treat multiple structures in a session. There's other classes of prolo solutions that are no longer in use, and they include chemotactic agents like sodium morate, which is a precursor to arachidonic acid. There's also irritants like pumice, which is also no longer in use. Ozone is still in use, and it's gaining popularity. It's referred to as prolozone. Then you have blood, blood products, platelet-rich plasma, stem cells. These are natural proliferants. The issue with that there is that they require costly equipment for the autologous donation, and you have very small volumes that you're working with. So what's the target? What is it that we're injecting? It's fascia, okay? It's bone and cartilage also. Fascia is defined as all fibrous connective tissue, including aponeuroses, ligaments, tendons, retinacula, joint capsules, organ, vessel tunics, saponarium, meninges, etc. Okay, with prolotherapy, we primarily target the ligaments, tendons, and the joint capsules. So to effectively diagnose and treat pain, we need to understand the osteopathic principles in biotensegrity model. The father of osteopathy is Dr. Andrew Still. He postulated that the body is a unit, the body is self-regulating and self-healing. Structure and function are interrelated, and rational treatment is based on understanding these principles. So now let's look at what that means from a physics standpoint. Structure is related to function. The body is held together by a network of tension and compression units, much like this tensegrity structure. Okay. How is it that this huge thing sits only on three pillars and it doesn't fall over? Okay. The term tensegrity was coined by R. Buckminster Fuller. He defined it as a characteristic property of a stable 3D structure made up of contiguous parts under tension and other parts that are under compression. So Steve Levin, he applied this concept to the body and coined it biotensegrity, where the bones are the compressive elements and the fascia or connective tissue keep the tension in the body. This is how a ballerina can stand on her toes and not fall over. If you look at the many layers of tissue that hold the bones together, you can appreciate the interrelatedness of each structure. The body will redistribute tension to compensate for any abnormal stress or injury to an area. When treating pain, we need to be good detectives to understand at which level the pain generators are coming from. So if biotensegrity is disrupted, mechanoreceptors in the nerve endings send a signal for pain. That's nociceptive pain. Your body will try to compensate by altering the structure to maintain function. You get muscle spasms, myofascial dysfunction, nerve impingement, abnormal muscle memory, inflammation, gait changes, scoliosis, etc. Now, if the laxity of the tensile strength is not corrected sufficiently to stop mechanoreceptors, then you get chronic illnesses with chronic pain, loss of function, tendinopathy, degeneration, arthritis. You get nerve inflammation, which is then the neuropathic pain. Now, neuropathic pain arises from constriction or injury to a central or peripheral nerve, which causes nerve inflammation, the nerve swells, and a release of substances like CGRP, substance P, and cytokines. They cause pain, they cause neovascularization, swelling, and tissue breakdown. Now, John Liftoff from New Zealand, he found that when you inject dextrose at low concentrations like D5W around the nerve, you can stop the neurogenic inflammation cascade. His method of cutaneous nerve treatment for pain is called perineural injection therapy, or PIT. It was formerly known as neural prolotherapy, or the Liftoff technique. There's many names for it. It's very important to note that PIT is different from traditional prolo, which uses high dose dextrose, 10 to 25%, to stimulate tissue regeneration. I will discuss the multiple biologic effects of dextrose in the research section of my talk. Okay. Overall, our goal is to restore biotensegrity, normalize function, and stop pain. So it's important to figure out where the pain is coming from. So when you disrupt biotensegrity, what occurs at the molecular level? It's inflammation. Popular culture thinks that inflammation is bad. Okay. This is on Time magazine. It notes that it's the secret killer. I tell my patients that not all inflammation is bad. There's always good and bad in both. Inflammation is our body's natural mechanism to heal. So the force is strong within. So this is the analogy that I normally describe to patients when I talk about inflammation. I say, if you sprain your ankle, what happens? Blood flow increases to get the cells to the area to fix it. The increased perfusion causes swelling and pain. This is inflammation. This is the good type of inflammation. Within hours, monocytes and fibroblasts come to the scene, growth factors are secreted, and osteocytes and chondrocytes initiate the healing cascade. Procollagen converts to collagen as repair and remodeling occurs. But there are many factors that inhibit wound healing. here are some examples. You've got the COX inhibitors, NSAIDs, steroids, chronic illnesses, immunocompromised states, older age, tobacco, tendon ligaments have poor blood supply, so structural properties. And when that happens, you get more incomplete healing, you get chronic instability, you get degenerative arthritis, neurogenic inflammation, and chronic pain. With regenerative therapy, we reinitiate inflammation and we reinitiate that healing cascade to optimize repair and alleviate pain. It's important to know where the pain generators are coming from to accurately treat the pain. I keep saying that, but there's so many different levels that you have to think about when you think of pain. If you compare this normal MRI, this on the left, with this MRI, which patient do you think has pain? This is a true case, okay? It's important that you realize this is the person that has pain, even though their MRI is normal. This is nociplastic pain. This particular person really doesn't have any pain. I was very shocked when I saw that MRI and I said, what, you don't have any pain? Well, that is true. So treat the patient, not the imaging study. So where else does our pain come from? There's the nerve pain patterns. They come from nerve roots and dermatomal pain patterns. You need to know also the cutaneous nerves, which gives you the sensory distributions that you can see here. In medical school, we're taught about this, okay, these dermatomal things, but nobody ever teaches us about this. I didn't learn about this until I went to learn about Prolo. These are sclerotomal patterns, or basically ligamentous referral patterns. And George Hackett published this in his book in 1956 that he published. So we're going to go a little bit now, not a little bit, a lot, into prolotherapy. Prolo history is that George Hackett, he was a general surgeon in the 1930s. He noted that when you inject hernia patients with a proliferant at the junction or the enthesis where the ligament bone attach, you get profuse proliferation of new tissue at the site. So he coined this term called prolotherapy as the rehabilitation of an incompetent structure, usually a ligament or a tendon, by the generation of new cellular tissue. He made his first publication in 1956. Then George Hackett taught Dr. Gus Hemwall, a Chicago surgeon. He was so impressed with the effectiveness of Prolo that he formed a nonprofit organization to teach others via service learning trips to Honduras. One of his students was Jeff Patterson, who's a professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, who expanded the scope of the organization to include conferences at the university, cadaver workshops, palpation working labs, and more international service learning trips. The organization has taught physicians from over 30 plus countries since 1969. So indications for Prolo: it's used for soft tissue repair, tendinopathy or ligament injury. You can have joint injuries with traumatic or degenerative that will respond well to prolotherapy. You can treat hypermobility syndromes. Prolo can help prevent surgery. It can shorten rehab time. It can enhance post-surgical healing. But Prolo can't fix everything. Okay, so you need to know the contraindications to Prolo. Active infection, cancer, acute non-reduced dislocations, known allergies to the Prolo solutions, prosthetic joint injections. And relative contraindications include chronic narcotic use, steroid or NSAID use, altered anatomy or anticoagulation, rheumatoid arthritis. Potential complications: you get local pain, bleeding, inflammatory flare response. I tell patients that this is really not a true complication. It's exactly what I want. I'm trying to stimulate inflammation. So if you're not inflamed for 2 to 3 days after my treatment, then I'll call you back a little bit earlier and I will crank up the solution and give you something a little stronger to stimulate your immune cells. You can get vasovagal, allergic responses, anaphylaxis, infection rate if you don't clean well. There's arterial injections that can lead to arteritis, thrombosis, ischemia, or venous thrombosis. If you inject at the nerves, you can get neuritis or paralysis. spinal injections. You have to be careful not to, to injure the spinal cord. You can get a spinal headache, epidural abscess, arachnoiditis, and pneumothorax anytime you're injecting these particular areas. So now we're going to go into all the fun stuff and go into the Prolo research. So we'll review the new objectives. We'll review Prolo research history, rationale for Prolo, dextrose Prolo mechanism, basic science, animal studies, clinical research highlights. I will review the key randomized control trials and systematic reviews with some interesting case reports. Then we will review everything that we just learned in terms of the research, and we'll discuss future directions of research for Prolo. So Prolo research has significantly increased in the last decade. We started with case series, case studies that caught people's attention. Then more and better designed studies appeared, like randomized controlled studies. So Prolo research has really grown. We now have systematic reviews, which is the highest level of evidence in research. In 2015, Dr. David Romago established the University of Wisconsin Prolotherapy Education and Research Lab, which is also known as UW-PERL. That resulted in many peer-reviewed research articles, collaborative projects with colleagues around the world, and descriptive reviews, letters, commentaries, book chapters on Prolo. And because of this work, local health insurance companies started to pay for prolotherapy. Every year, except for this year due to the pandemic, the Hackett Hemel Patterson Foundation hosts an annual Prolo research symposium at the University of Wisconsin, with speakers from around the world talking about their research. Now let's go back and review the conventional wisdom for why we do Prolo and address it from a research perspective. So we always thought that Prolo is a way to treat chronic pain, and chronic pain is associated with laxity or degenerative tendons, ligaments, and intra-articular tissues, and that dextrose Prolo causes a local healing response, which promotes analgesia through stimulated tissue revitalization and direct effect on pain response. But what is the evidence? What's the science for this? So for the rest of this talk, Einstein will walk us through some questions. We'll review the literature to find the answer. We'll first address the topic of dextrose mechanism. Our first question will be, does Prolo cause tissue change in injured ligamentous tissue? And does Prolo cause an inflammatory response? So early evidence from Hackett's publication is supported by current research, like O's rabbit studies. So Hackett injected rabbits with Prolo and showed that pre and post x-rays demonstrate that the bone growth is a lot more after 3 months. This is the control, this is the Prolo. Similarly, he looked at rabbit tendons and he showed that this is the control, and 9 months later, you can see that there's huge growth here in the rabbit tendon size over 9 months as well as 12 months. Then in 2008, O published a study on rabbit carpal tunnel, Prolo. And you can see that the collagen bundle thickening at 8 weeks in the transverse carpal ligament of the rabbit is significant. This is the control and this is the dextrose. So yes, Prolo induces fibroosis and connective tissue proliferation. Let's see now, take a look at Prolo and inflammation. Hackett did rabbit studies and he showed that lymphocyte infiltration occurs at 48 hours after injection. He showed that in injured rat Achilles, he compared D20 versus no treatment and showed that more fibroblasts were in the D20 group after 4 weeks compared to no treatment. Jensen studied non-injured rat MCLs. He did dry needling versus normal saline versus D15. And 24 hours after the D15 treatment, he noted that macrophages and leukocytes were more compared to normal saline and dry needling control. So yes, Prolo causes inflammation. Now, let's move on to human studies. I will now review clinical research highlighting the most well-done randomized controlled studies and systematic reviews for different MSK conditions. We'll review the evidence for prolo efficacy, which is the ability to produce an effect, and the effectiveness or degree to which something is successful in producing a desired result or excess. So we'll start with dextrose mechanism in humans. The question to ask here is, does dextrose have a direct analgesic effect? In 2016, Dr. Lisa Smigel published a double-blind randomized control trial to assess the short-term analgesic effects of D5W epidural injections compared to normal saline. She had 35 adults who had moderate to severe non-surgical low back pain with radiation to the glutes or leg for about 10 years. That's pretty significant. She did a blinded vertical caudal injection techniques that she confirmed by epidurogram afterwards. And she looked at the numerical rating scale at 0, 15 minutes, and 2, 4, and 48 hours, and finally at 2 weeks post-treatment. And this is what she found. So on this numerical rating scale, 10 is the max in terms of how sad, how bad your pain is. Okay. At baseline, these patients actually started off at a 6, okay? And you can see that the red is the dextrose. So the dextrose patients had greater change in their NRS pain scores compared to the normal saline at 15 minutes, all the way up to 48 hours, but not at 2 weeks. The percentage of patients with more or equal to 50% pain reduction at 4 hours was 84%. For the dextrose group and 19% for normal saline. That's a huge, huge difference. She also demonstrated that D5W caudal injection is safe. In a follow-up study, she showed that bi-weekly treatment resulted in improvement in pain and disability up to 12 months. So yes, this study suggests that D5 has direct neurogenic effect on pain at the dorsal root level. So it is analgesic. Now, we have to think in terms of the mechanism, is it really regenerative? Okay, so we have to look at pre and post imaging. Ryan in 2010 did studies on Achilles tendinosis. He showed that the patients had significant decrease in tendon tear size, but no change in the tendon thickness. Robigo, in his lateral epicondylosis study, showed that these patients had significant clinical benefit, but no MRI changes at 16 weeks. Bertrand in 2016 showed in her rotator cuff tendinopathy study that these patients had significant clinical improvement, but no significant ultrasound changes at 9 months. So what's really happening here? It shows us that it's mixed data. It's more complicated than we know. In research, there's a line, there's a saying that the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. I'll say it again, that was a mouthful. When I first heard it, I was like, what was that? So it's the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So you can look at it in a different way. You can say, well, maybe our machine's ability to detect change is not sensitive enough. So here's a study to address that. Topol in Argentina took 6 patients with severe knee OA with denuded medial condyles. He did 6 monthly dextrose injections, and he did pre and post arthroscopy. He looked at using quantitative polarized light microscopy and immunohistologic staining. I honestly don't know who in the world would actually agree to doing pre and post arthroscopy, but he got the study done. And it's very significant. So the results show that almost half of these areas assessed show signs of hyaline cartilage growth. So if you look at this image, these are patient A, patient B, and patient C. And pre-treatment, the blue is methylene stain, and it's staining the cartilage. Post-treatment here, you can see that there's significantly more blue in this column than there is in this column. This is suggestive for regeneration, but this is a small study without randomization. So now let's look at the cleanest, clearest, and best reported randomized control trial that brought prolotherapy into the radar of conventional medicine. We're going to address knee osteoarthritis, a common debilitating condition. And we'll ask, what effect does dextrose prolo have on knee quality of life measures? And can prolo help with knee OA? So, and this is a study done by David Robigo and Jeff Patterson, published in Annals of Family Medicine 2013. He blinded dextrose versus saline versus home exercise program. They did intra-articular and extra-articular injections at 1, 5, and 9 weeks, plus or minus 13 and 17 weeks. Everyone got a home exercise program that was a manual as well as in-person instruction. They had 90 adults and with more than 3 months of painful osteoarthritis. Then they looked at the WOMAC score and the pain scale. The WOMAC score is basically a bunch of questionnaires that address their quality of life. Then they looked at the data at before the treatment and by phone at 26 and 52 weeks. And this is the result. So the WOMAC score here is the quality of life. So the higher the number, the better you are. And when these people started off here, dextrose is the red line. You can see that within 10 weeks, these patients started to get better. Their quality of life improved and it sustained all the way out to a year. Saline also improved as well, but not as much as the dextrose. Exercise, we know there is a benefit with exercise. We always prescribe our osteoarthritis patients exercise. So they do improve, but it kind of peters out and it doesn't improve as well as the dextrose. There's this thing in research called the minimal clinical important difference, or the MCID. For the WOMAC score, that MCID is 12. So the higher the difference, the better it is. In this study, the prolo resulted in a 15.3-point average improvement. That's significantly more than that 12-point cutoff that you needed. So they also showed that the use of prescription post-procedure opioids resulted in rapid decrease in injection-related pain. Nowadays, we always try to avoid opioids because of the opioid crisis. Usually my patients, when I do knee injections, they rarely need any more than Tylenol. Dr. Robigo also demonstrated that satisfaction with prolo was high with this treatment and there were no adverse events. So he did a follow-up study in 2015 and took a post-clinical trial with an open label follow-up. So he did the same people that he had originally. He took those people and then he took another open label group of patients and from another open label study. So he had a total of 65 patients. He didn't inject them anymore. He just asked them 2.5 years later after their initial prolotherapy treatment, how are they doing? And we're going to reassess their WOMAC scores. This is what he found. Remember that the MCID at 12 shows statistically significant changes. So he showed that of all these subjects, 62% of them improved by more than 12 points. And this is sustained all the way out to 2.5 years. That's pretty darn good. So if you break up, this is the average, the black is the average line. If you break up that and you see that there are some people who are non-responders, and then there are some people who are responders. So the non-responders, you have to think, well, what happened there? How I look at it is that the disease process continues. 2.5 years ago, they got their prolo treatment and maybe they're continuing to gain weight, continuing to get older, et cetera, things that will decrease the healing response. So they start to peter off and then they start to get worse than when they first started with the initial study. So maybe an intervention sometime here, they might respond, maybe not, that we don't know. But overall, the majority of these subjects, 62% of them improved. So the conclusions for this study is that dextrose prolo is an effective long-term treatment for most patients with mild to severe OA refractory to conservative care. And prolo performed by trained operators is safe. The results are meaningful and sustained over 2.5 years on a validated knee OA specific pain, function, and stiffness measure. That's the WOMAC score. So then what did the rest of society do after they saw this? Okay, the journal Family Practice in 2014 brought Prolo into the spotlight in conventional care. They actually wrote in their practice changer, recommend Prolo for patients with knee OA that does not respond to conventional therapies. That is huge because that's the first time a conventional journal made a recommendation for alternative therapy like that. So our next question should be, is Prolo injection intra-articular only helpful for knee OA? Because if you notice that both Robigo studies, they did X-ray and intra-articular. And this is a very important question to ask because in any type of a residency program, whether it's PM&R, family medicine, sports medicine, what they teach us is to do a corticosteroid injection, just one into the joint. So now if we were to change that substance to dextrose, will it be very beneficial? We're going to see three studies, okay? This one was published 20 years ago by Dr. Dean Reeves, okay? What he did was he compared dextrose 10% with lido, compared that with just the lido by itself, and he did bi-monthly treatments three times. And then he did an open label study and he followed them up at 0, 6, and 12 months. And he found that there was an improvement in pain, in swelling, buckling episodes, and knee flexion range with just the intra-articular injection. 20 years later, Regina Sitz did a similar study. She took 5 mils of normal saline, compared that with 5 mils of 25% dextrose. And she had more people in this study, looked at it at 16 weeks, 20, 26, and 52 weeks. And she found that they had decreased pain and improved function and quality of life. That's huge. Now, remember I showed you that study that Topol did, where he was looking at the chondrogenic effects of intra-articular dextrose, the one with the blue cartilage staining? That was just one inside the joint also. And he showed there's positive clinical and chondrogenic effects. So, when Einstein asks, you can Prolo help with knee OA, what's the answer? Oh yes. And is the combo of extra and intra-articular injections effective? Yes, because you're fixing the biotin integrity. That's the beauty of Prolo, is you've got enough solution. It's not limited like PRP or stem cells. You've got plenty to treat all the biotin integrity structures. And are intra-articular injections only effective in knee OA? The answer is yes. Oops, sorry, we're going forward. So our next question is, how does Prolo compare to other treatments for knee OA? So in this study, this is a systematic review that was done recently in August of 2019. They took 10 randomized controls and a total of 328 patients who had Prolo, compared it with 348 controls that were either anesthetics or hyaluronic acid, ozone, PRP, or radiofrequency. They looked at the pain reduction and function improvement and found that Prolo did better than the anesthetic alone. Prolo was equivalent to the HA or hyaluronic acid, that should be ozone, O3, not O2, sorry for the typo, and radiofrequency. But Prolo was not as effective as the PRP, sorry for another typo, and EPO. So another question we'll ask, moving on to another topic, is can Prolo help with tendinosis? And can Prolo be done in kids? So Oshkosh-Schlatter patellotendinopathy. OSD, we always used to think it was just an apophysitis due to repetitive strain on the secondary ossification centers of the tibial tuberosity. But current literature depicts that OSD is really a degeneration of both the tendon and the apophyseal tissue. So Rosenberg, he showed that when he took his sequential MRIs of adolescents with symptoms of OSD, 100% of these kids actually had patellar tendon pathology, and only 32% had ossicle formation issues. So we should try Prolo on these people, or these kids. So let's see how they do. this is a study done by Topol. This is the same guy who did the arthroscopic pre and post study. And it was published in Journal Pediatrics in 2011. He had 52 patients that met his OSD criteria. All of these groups had more than 2 months of formal physical therapy, which is standard of care. If they still had pain more than 3 months, then they got randomized. They got randomized to home exercise program only for 3 months. They got to 1% lido only, and they would get monthly injections for 3 months. And the last group was the dextrose, 12.5% dextrose with lido, and they got monthly injections for 3 months. Then at 3 months, he unblinded them and said, well, if you want to cross over to the dextrose group, you can go ahead and do so. And we'll look at the data in 1 year. And the data he used, or the scale that he used, was called inertial pain phase score, which is specific for sports pain. So this is his data. The NPS, NPPS score, the higher it is, the worse it is. At a level of 4, it's pain affecting performance and mild pain with activities of daily life. So here you've got dextrose is the black line. If you start injecting these kids within three months, their pain score goes from 4.5 down to almost zero. That's really impressive, because these kids would otherwise have had to sit out and not play sports until their growth plates close. That's what most sports docs would tell them, okay? And this here, it actually is sustained to almost to zero a year out. Now, if you look at the red line, is the home exercise only. With home exercise, we know it improves, but it kind of tapers off right here at about 2.5. So these kids, they're still having pain. Look at the crossover. The crossover is these patients who started off with just home exercise, and they're not getting very much improvement. So at the open label time at 3 months, they said, okay, do you want to go ahead and get injected? So these kids go and get injected. Now they drop, just like the Prolo group originally. And within 3 months, these kids get better. That's pretty significant. Now, if you compare dextrose with lidocaine injections, they start off here, and there's the dextrose line. The lidocaine is definitely not an inert control. You can see that lidocaine does improve their pain scores. And here's the crossover. They have some improvement with the lidocaine, but once you put dextrose in there, they have a significantly more rapid decline in that pain score. That's pretty impressive. So once again, the Journal of Family Practice put Prolo in the spotlight in conventional care. And in 2012, they wrote their practice changer with a strength A recommendation that says, consider giving dextrose lidocaine injections to adolescents with OSD that persist despite physical therapy. That's huge, but how many people know about this? Not too many. I'm gonna share with you a very interesting case here. This is a case, Prolotherapy in the Olympics. This is a 13-year-old male patient of mine with OSD knee pain affecting sport. He ice skates and he does gymnastics 6 to 8 hours a day. He came to me for pain and I said, gosh, you know, when you do that much exercise, I'm really worried that that tendon's just gonna rip off the tibial tuberosity, and had him sign all the consents and everything before we do this treatment. But he insisted. He said, no, this is, you know, and his mom was there, he says, it's my passion. This is, I have to continue doing this. So he got prolotherapy, monthly treatments, about 5 treatments, interspersed with 3 D5W PIT treatments. He continued to practice during treatment, and because he was an Olympic hopeful. And then in 2018, he made it to the Olympics. This is Nathan Chen. And so he says, thank you for helping me get back on the ice. Without prolotherapy, I never would have been able to get the training time I needed to make it to the Olympics. Miracle worker. That's a really nice story. So reviewing the evidence, can Prolo help with tendinosis, specifically OSD or patellar tendinopathy? The answer is yes. Can Prolo be done on kids? Totally yes. So our next question, what about other tendinopathies? Do injections have to be at the anesthesis to be effective? And are effects measurable with ultrasound imaging pre and post treatment? We're going to look at rotator cuff tendinopathy because rotator cuff tendinopathy affects 1 in 5 shoulders. Okay, Workers' Comp Board of British Columbia showed that each case of rotator cuff injury costs about $24,300 a year. That's pretty significant. This study is done by Helene Bertrand from Canada, published in 2016. She took 73 people who had more than 3 months of shoulder pain and exam findings of rotator cuff tendinopathy with ultrasound confirmed supraspinatus tendinosus or tear. She randomized these people to enthesis dextrose, and all of these patients are going to have lidocaine in the group. So enthesis dextrose, enthesis lido, or superficial lido mixed with the normal saline. All these people got 3 monthly injections, and they also had 2 physical therapy sessions after each injection. They were instructed to do home physical therapy 3 times a week for 3 months. Then she followed them up at 9 months. She looked at the VAS pain score, their satisfaction in terms of their treatment, and improvement in ultrasound shoulder pathology rating scale. And this is what she found. So this here is 9 months follow-up, and these are the 3 different groups, the enthesis dextrose, enthesis normal saline, and superficial normal saline that was injected not at the enthesis. So if you're looking at the percentage of patients with twice the MICD for VAS improvement in pain, and recall that MICD is the minimal clinical important difference, okay? So what that translates to in normal language is that in the enthesis dextrose group, 59% of these people had had improvement in their pain by twofold. That's pretty significant. Here you can see the enthesis with the normal saline also improved, but it did not improve as much as the dextrose. And normal saline superficial also improved, but definitely not as significant as the dextrose. That's what I just said. And then satisfaction for treatment was significantly greater in the enthesis dextrose group compared to the superficial normal saline group. So Helene found that repeat ultrasound imaging showed no significant change within or between groups. And so she concluded that differences cannot be attributed to regenerative effect. So in review of the questions we asked, is Prolo effective for other tendinopathies? The animation didn't work correctly here. Okay, there it is. The answer is yes. Do injections have to be at the enthesis to be effective? The answer is yes, it is more effective at the enthesis. And are effects measurable on ultrasound? The answer is no. So let's go and review a different case, okay? Temporal mandibular dysfunction, okay? I like to talk about this one because in conventional medicine, there's not that many treatments that we can do for TMJ dysfunction, short of appliances and sometimes dental surgery. So TMJ affects up to about 15% of adults and 7% of adolescents. We'll ask, can Prolo help with TMJ? Francois Liu, in May of 2019, he published this in the Mayo Clinic Proceedings called The Treatment of TMJ Dysfunction with Hypertonic Dextrose Injection, a randomized control trial with long-term partial crossover. He had 42 patients, but total 54 joints. He had 2 groups. One was the dextrose and lidocaine, compared that with just the lidocaine. And he did 3 monthly palpation-guided intra-articular injections. Then he did an open label at 3 months. And the outcomes is he looked at the numerical rating scale for pain, which is from 0 to 10, for facial pain and jaw dysfunction. He looked at the maximal intersizal opening, like how big they can open their mouth, basically. And then he looked at the percentage of joints with more than or equal to 50% improvement in pain, function, and satisfaction. And this is what he found. So dextrose is the red line. This is going out to a year. At 3 months, they did open label, okay? So we want this number to be as high as possible to show that their pain is improved. So you can see here, even after the first month, the first injection, these patients are seeing improvement, which consistently increases after each treatment that they had. This is the Lido, the blue one is the Lido. So Lido again is not inert, so Lido does help. But the effects taper off. So then at 3 months, you ask these people, hey, do you want to cross over to the dextrose? They say, sure. So they get dextrose and you can see that there's a substantial improvement in their pain. What about their dysfunction? TMJ dysfunction, which basically means they have difficulty chewing, they have jaw fatigue with eating, they have tension in their jaw, or they grind their teeth or clench their teeth. So looking at this, you can see that dextrose is very helpful. Okay, here's the lidocaine only. And then you do open label, they respond like just the dextrose with significant improvement. So in summary, the Prolo resulted in significant improvement in jaw pain function and the mouth opening compared to control at 3 months. Clinical improvements endured to 12 months and the satisfaction was high. That's pretty cool. So can Prolo help with TMJ? Totally yes. We'll ask our next question is, can Prolo help with plantar fasciitis? And are effects measurable with ultrasound imaging pre and post treatment? Recall that the rotator cuff, when the Helene Bertrand showed, it did not have ultrasound imaging changes. So what we'll look at here, this is just fresh off the press here in April of 2020, Mansi's Kaplan published this double-blind randomized control trial with 30 patients. The intervention was they took 15% dextrose mixed with the lidocaine normal saline, compared that with lidocaine normal saline control. The total amount of solution that they injected was 10 mils. They did palpation-guided injections at the plantar fascia, at the first and fifth metatarsal, and at the heel in three areas. They did two treatments separated by 3 weeks. The outcomes, they looked at 0 and 7 and 15 weeks post-treatment. Then they compared the pain intensity VAS scores during activity and at rest. And they did this they used this foot function index to measure the pain and the disability. And they checked the ultrasound. They measure the thickness of the plantar fascia at 0 and 15 weeks. And these are the results. So both groups improved in their VAS scores during activity, at rest, foot function index up to 15 weeks. Prolo did significantly better at both 7 and 15 weeks compared to normal saline. And the plantar fascia thickness measured at 7 and 15 weeks was significantly higher in Prolo groups compared to the control. And that P is less than 0.001. That's very statistically significant. So the question is, can Prolo help with plantar fasciitis? Totally yes. Are effects measurable with ultrasound imaging pre and post? Yes. So let's take a quick break with a feel-good story. I like to tell you about the first kid I ever injected, okay? It's Pablo's story about pediatric plantar fasciitis and pes planus. Pablo was a 14-year-old boy with chronic bilateral plantar foot pain and severe pes planus. He was volunteering for the HHPF Guadalajara, Mexico Prolotherapy Service Learning Trip. And he translated for the patients as they told their story about the many years of pain they had and how even after just one Prolo treatment, they got better. So they would come back year after year. So Pablo was so impressed by the Prolo that he asked his mother, this is his mother Moni here, if he could get this feet treated because they hurt so bad, he sometimes had to limp. At that time, I had never injected kids before. So I asked Dr. Jeff Patterson and he said, sure, why not? Prolo is safe and effective. So I injected both Pablo's feet. I returned the next year and a tall, skinny, good-looking kid greeted me at the hotel. I didn't recognize him until he said, "It's me, Pablo." His feet were so much better. He joined the football team, lost weight, and had a growth spurt. Last year, he graduated college and is still helping with the service learning trips. So can Prolo help with plantar fasciitis? The answer is yes. And can kids get their feet injected? Totally yes. It does hurt though. So sometimes you have to use a lot of different techniques to make sure to help with the analgesia. Okay, so let's go now and review prolotherapy and low back pain. Low back pain is such a huge problem, as we discussed at the beginning of the talk. It's a huge economic burden everywhere worldwide. This is C. Everett Koop. He was the U.S. Surgeon General during the Reagan era in the 1980s. He said, "I have been a patient who has benefited from prolotherapy, having been so remarkably relieved of my chronic disabling back pain, I began to use it on some of my patients." So do we take his word for it, or do we look at the evidence? So we always look at the evidence. So in terms of back studies, there's not very many back studies if you search PubMed. Okay, in the 1980s to 1990s, there were only three low back pain randomized controlled trials. Two of them were positive, one was negative. Each of them had their own flaws. They had some anecdotal and experimental evidence that was contradictory, confounding factors. They used different solutions. So it didn't give us much information until Mike Yellen in 2004 published this study. It's the biggest, most rigorous, longest duration randomized controlled trial for low back pain published in the journal Spine. He took glucose prolo, compared that with normal saline with and without physical therapy. He had 110 patients with non-specific low back pain with an average of 14 years. He divided them into two groups. One was the glucose with lido, and the other one is just normal saline. Then he further divided these groups into glucose lido with physical therapy and one without physical therapy, and did the same for the normal saline. Normal saline with physical and normal physical therapy and one without. All these people got injections every 2 weeks for a total of six injections. And then they had some as needed or PRN treatments at 4, 6, and 12 months. The thing that's really important to note is that these patients only got five injections per side. It is not anywhere near a comprehensive approach in terms of treating low back pain, which can be anywhere between 10 to 20 to 30 points, depending on what the dysfunction is and how the biotensegrity is in that area. Then what he did was he looked at the VAS score and he looked at the disability questionnaires at 0, 2.5, 4, 6, 12, and 24 months. He had very good follow-up, okay? 99% of these people had follow-up to 6 months, 96% followed up in 1 year, 80% up to 2 years. That's excellent. So these are his results, okay? The graph looks pretty much similar, okay? You can see that both saline, which is that pink line, and glucose, which is the darker purple line, significantly improved compared to the baseline. So here is their VAS pain score. The higher it is, the worse it is. So if they started here, all these people improved compared to their baseline, but there was no significant difference between saline and glucose in our prolo injections. Now, you have to keep in mind, this is an underpowered study, so it's harder to tell the difference between the groups also. But at the same time, it illustrates the difficulty of saline or other injection controls, because saline in itself, as you can see with all the other studies, it's not an inert substance. And also you're poking them with a needle. Okay, so that also is inducing trauma to the tissue. So when you look at a study like this, let me go back for a second here. Back then, they had to report this study as a negative study. So if you're doing your PubMed search on low back pain and systematic reviews on it, you're going to see that it reports it as didn't do any better than the sham control or the control. But as astute researchers, we have to actually look at all the research data and really analyze it well. Because if you look at this, okay, we're going to, this is the data, the low back pain and disability at 12 months. This is the dextrose prolo. This is, glucose prolo. This is normal saline. This table shows the percentage of people with 50% improvement in their pain and in their disability. So in the glucose group, 46% of the people said, half of my pain is better, okay? And 42% of these people said, I'm not as disabled as I was, you know, before the treatment. And then you compare that to the saline people, they also improved as well. So if you put this into effect, you have to think also, if I told you that I can make your back pain 50%, let me correct that. If I told you that the chances of you having 50% better improvement in your pain is 46%, would you try that? Or would you try something else like surgical interventions? So you have to put this into perspective. Low back pain is multifaceted, okay? There's so many things that's going on into play with the sacral pelvis region, the biotin integrity in that area. And Yellen's treatment was not a comprehensive low back prolo treatment. He only did 5 shots. So these results are actually pretty darn good, okay? They're at least as good as those reported for spinal cord stimulation, surgery, or a multidisciplinary treatment for low back pain of shorter duration. So is this significant? Yes, it is, okay? Despite the fact that it was reported as not significant. So can prolo help with low back pain? Answer is yes. Let's ask a different question. Can prolo help with sacroiliac pain? We'll be more precise this time. And how does it compare to corticosteroid injections? So this here is a randomized control trial for intra-articular prolo compared to corticosteroids for the SI joint, and a randomized control trial in 2010 done in Korea. They took 48 patients with sacroiliac pain, confirmed by more than or equal to 50% improvement with local anesthetic block that lasted more than 3 months. And these patients failed medical treatment. So the intervention is dextrose, compared that to triamcinolone. And they had fluoroscopic guidance with their injections. They did biweekly treatments with a maximum of 3 treatments. They looked at the pain disability scores at baseline, 2 weeks, and monthly. Oops, what happened here? Okay. So the results show significant improvement in pain and disability scores from baseline in both groups at 2 weeks with no significant difference between them. Okay, that's great. Both of them work. So now you have 2 things that you can use. But if you were to look at long-term, you can see here that the prolo effects lasted longer than the steroid. This is at 15 months. This is the percentage of people with more than or equal to 15% improvement in pain. So steroids, only 10% of those people had their pain improved by 50%. Versus dextrose, 58.7% of those people had pain improvement by more than 50%. So Einstein says, yes, prolo can help with sacroiliac pain. So let's summarize everything now. Okay, there is a great study. This is a systematic review done by Regina Sitz and published in 2016 that shows the strength, correction, I need to drink a water for a second, take a quick break. It shows all the other studies, all the other body parts that I didn't review. But instead of levels of randomized control, it's actually described as strength of recommendation grades, or the SORT category. So a category A grade will tell you it's consistent, good quality, patient-oriented evidence. B is inconsistent or limited quality, patient-oriented evidence. And C is consensus, disease-oriented evidence, usual practice, expert opinion, or case series or studies. Okay. So when you look at NEOA, remember this was published in 2016. There are more studies since 2016. If you look at NEOA, the findings show that dextrose affects positive and significantly beneficial and symptomatic NEOA. So that grade, I would call that an A and not a B since the publication. Ashgood Slaughter. In this journal, they actually put it as an A, but I would call that a B also because there's only one study. There's no other study in Ashgood Slaughter. Low back pain. Low back pain we just discussed, that's a B. And SI injections, so intra-articular dextrose compared to corticosteroid resulted in superior long-term pain reduction. We just reviewed that. Rotator cuff tendinopathy, that's also a B. Now, finger OA. So if you had a patient who had finger pain due to OA, I mean, what can you do for it? In regular conventional medicine, not very much, right? You give them pain medicine, but now they have an option because there's a study here that's published in, I do believe it's 2000 by Dean Reeves that says 10% dextrose compared to corticosteroid injections showed that dextrose was superior in pain reduction and functional improvement. Okay. And that was at the TMC, the thumb, all the different little joints in the fingers too, the PIPs and the DIPs. So dextrose does improve pain and joint flexibility significantly more than the control, and that was a B score. So TMJ, we just reviewed, this is a B here, but there's been more better studies since 2016. So I would venture to say that's probably an A now. Achilles, I didn't have time to actually review with you the Achilles, but dextrose prolo combined with the standard of care, which is the eccentric loading exercises, results in better functional outcomes and improved pain reduction at 12 months compared to the exercises alone. Lateral epicondylosis, there's excellent studies for that now. Dextrose and dextrose with sodium morate improve function and pain levels in comparison with the delayed treatment control group. I should also put in a little footnote here that this study, I do believe, was published in 2013. Since then, Dr. Robigo has published with Mike Yellen a new study in 2019 that shows that dextrose prolo compared to dextrose prolo compared to physical therapy, they were both equally effective. Okay, so it didn't do any better than the physical therapy. Now that's perfect physical therapy, and as you know, physical therapy there's a range of good and bad physical therapists. So the plantar fasciosis, I did review with you guys. And you can see that with plantar fasciosis, both dextrose PRP, they resulted in clinical statistical significance and improvement, and that was a B score. Okay. So research conclusions. Basic evidence in animal studies support biologic effects of dextrose on normal and injured tissue. Clinical trials support prolo as a positive treatment in OA, tendinopathy, and back pain. And the systematic reviews or meta-analysis support randomized controlled study findings in the OA. There's clinical benefit in human studies not explained by proliferation alone. The mechanism of dextrose prolo is likely multifactorial. But the bottom line is prolo is safe, practical, and efficacious. It's a therapeutic strategy to treat ligamentous laxity, tendinopathies, arthritic conditions, and back pain. So what's the future direction in research for prolo? The goal is to replicate the existing clinical trials. Then we add effectiveness studies, compare prolo to other active treatments. We add better measures, maybe functional outcomes and biomarkers. And we do more collaborative interdisciplinary teamwork with the research. Something that's really important to remember that you got to keep an open mind about things, because even if we think we're scrutinizing things under a magnifying glass, the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So again, everything you do has got to be patient-centered in terms of treatment for pain with patients. Okay? I'm going to summarize. I'm going to have Dr. David Robigo sum it up. This is him talking here. He says the thread connecting the dots of prolo research is present but thin. The thread connecting basic science, clinical science, and patient outcomes is there, but there are still very few studies. Prolo research is maturing. We're doing better than 10 years ago. We're moving fast. However, research is still in the early years. but the future is bright. So we're going to conclude here and we're going to put it all together. Okay, how can Prolo and everything we discussed today complement your practice? Let me share with you a case as an example. This is a case report of a patient of mine with hip labral tear, hip OA, and general total body pain. She's a 62-year-old female with hypermobility syndrome and hypothyroidism. She's otherwise healthy until a motor vehicle accident in 2004. She was referred to me to evaluate and treat a right hip labral tear. She had at that time 5 doctor appointments per week after a near-death experience on the freeway. A garbage truck lost control, hit the patient's car at 80 miles per hour. The car spun around, crossed 3 lanes, slammed into the concrete median, and she was going at 50 miles per hour. She bounced back across 4 lanes. That's horrific. And she says, after 3 years of chronic pain and highly trained Beverly Hills doctors, orthopedists, physiatrists, neurologists, chiropractors, acupuncturists, endless x-rays, MRIs, and lots of crying before I found Dr. Vuong. She had broken ribs, concussions with memory loss, but those things healed with time. What did not heal was her torn labrum. She was told she needed a new hip. Her torn meniscus in bilateral knee, she had chronic migraines, chronic neck, thoracic, and lower back pain with advanced disc and neck disease. She had foot pain, hand pain, shoulder pain, you just name it, and she's probably got all the pain there that I can remember. So she says, having tried conventional painkillers and shots with very little relief, I was suicidal. I believed my life would never be the same. I couldn't work, I couldn't walk, I couldn't travel. I couldn't take stairs. I would have to lie down on the grass and have my husband pull my hip out. I couldn't sit. I had trouble driving any distance, and I was in bed most of the time, the only place I felt comfortable. Wow, that's pretty horrific. So what did we do? What did I do? So my sister and I, told you, have a private practice called AcuProlo Institute. What we aim to do is restore biotensegrity at all levels. The AcuProlo method is doing osteopathic manual manipulation to realign the body, remove abnormal myofascial strains, do perineural injection therapy to treat the neurogenic pain, acupuncture to enhance energy circulation and promote healing, prolotherapy to regenerate ligaments, tendons, and bones. This is very important with a person with hypermobility like her, on top of her traumatic injuries. And then we do platelet-rich plasma, the stronger regenerative stimulant. And we also include the biopsychosocial techniques to release emotional stress and subconscious conditioning that can affect the body's homeostasis. So what did this patient get? In terms of prolotherapy and regenerative treatment, I listed all the number of Prolo treatments she had over the 4 years that I saw her. So I literally injected practically every joint in her body. She mentioned that I did 2 PRP injections into her hip. And she says, after all of that, I can say with conviction that these chronic symptoms are gone. After your extraordinary care, I can now walk 4 miles a day. I can sit in most chairs. I drive anywhere. I'm not afraid to be alive. I have hope. I laugh. I'm back at work 50 hours a week. I have my life back. I have my dreams back. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. I have not replaced my hip, my knee, or resorted to strong painkillers. Instead, I have sent my whole family to you for your precious help. Now, that was a really amazing thing when you can actually touch someone's life like that and you incorporate all the things that you've learned. So I'm very grateful to have participated in her care. As you can see, a multidisciplinary approach to treating pain, including Prolo regenerative treatment, can be very effective. So for those interested, there are many organizations that teach Prolo. My sister and I are teaching faculty for the HHPF and its sister organization, IART. We just had our annual conference with world-renowned speakers presenting. These other organizations, they also teach Prolo, the European School of Prolo, the AAOM and AOAPRM. So Prolo really is an art that requires years of practice and continuous learning with didactics and hands-on experience. You can't really do that without the hands-on experience. So we covered a lot of information today. I hope you found this presentation to be practical and useful in your practice. So thank you. This concludes my talk, but I'd like to show you a video about HHPF's legacy since 1969. And I hope that you can join us in our future service learning trips to provide compassionate care and spread the word about Prolo. Thank you. Our story began in 1969 when Dr. Gus Hemwall, a Chicago surgeon, established a foundation dedicated to providing free medical care to people in need. He named it after his mentor, Dr. George Hackett, who was a pioneer of prolotherapy, an injection treatment for chronic pain. Dr. Hemwall was so impressed by the effectiveness of prolotherapy, he made it his life's work and began organizing medical trips to Honduras. He invited colleagues to join him so he could teach others how to perform the treatment. One of these doctors was Jeff Patterson, a family physician and professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Dr. Patterson became the director of the foundation and, along with his partner, Mary Doherty, continued the tradition and expanded the scope of service learning trips. After his untimely death, we added his name to the foundation to honor his vision and inspiration. Today, our trips to Honduras include over 100 doctors and volunteers doing prolotherapy, treating vein disease and ear, nose, and throat disorders. Participants can earn continuing medical education credits through the University of Wisconsin-Madison. For months prior to the trips, volunteers collect and package supplies and donations from around the world to deliver to Honduran schools and hospitals. Teaching has always been at the heart of HHPF's mission. For the past 25 years, the foundation has co-sponsored an annual conference with the University of Wisconsin, inviting expert lecturers from around the world. The conference includes image-guided cadaver workshops and hands-on palpation and marking lab. Learners may then attend the HHPF annual service learning trips to further their skills with hands-on learning with experienced practitioners in Honduras and Guadalajara, Mexico for advanced prolotherapy training. With dedicated physicians and volunteers, we treat thousands of patients annually. Through compassionate medical care, we help relieve pain and suffering for many, and in return, they touch our hearts with gratitude and love. Participants on our trips develop lifelong friendships with one another and access to an international network of like-minded professionals. They also get to enjoy the beauty and culture of our international destinations. At the end of each service trip, participants rest and relax with an option to explore cultural excursions in Mexico and in Honduras on the island of Roatan. HHPF is a leader in promoting quality, reliability, and safety in prolotherapy. We have worked to standardize treatment methods to ensure accuracy, safety, and effectiveness. We combine quality teaching with hands-on training to optimize learning and patient outcomes. HHPF hosts an annual Prolotherapy Research Symposium and supports collaborative peer-reviewed clinical research with colleagues around the world through our affiliation with the University of Wisconsin Prolotherapy Education and Research Lab, founded by HHPF's former president, Dr. David Romico, in 2015. Since its beginnings in 1969, the foundation has taught thousands of doctors from over 30 countries. We are proud to have trained practitioners around the world who can offer their skills to patients in need. The strength of any organization lies in its people, and our foundation thanks all those who have contributed to our long history of excellence in teaching and service with your labor of love. In order to provide a membership association and expand training for practitioners, HHPF helped create the nonprofit International Association of Regenerative Therapy, or IART. HHPF and IART are partners with a shared vision to relieve pain and suffering in the world. Whether you are already a part of our family, thinking about becoming involved, or maybe willing to offer financial support, we appreciate your help in providing compassionate care for those in need. Please join our family. Visit us at hhpfoundation.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. Thank you, Lynn, for such a wonderful lecture.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for the opportunity to do so. I'm very passionate about it, and I hope you guys got something out of it that's useful.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing all this information, and we really learned a lot. And we won't be entertaining any questions anymore. But thank you for your goodness, for your generosity, and sharing all this. And we will try to post this in our YouTube so more people can listen and learn from you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.